Okay, so last one's mine, and I thought I'd sort of keep it on theme. What I'm doing now is we're doing a couple of research projects with Australia, South Korea, China, and possibly Germany, so some European organizations. And the thing we're trying to figure out is, so if you go through this conference, there are lots and lots of really interesting research on how to crunch data in different ways and generate interesting insights. But in most cases in organizations, it's happening sort of in point form. So the question is, how do we build this across the organization as a way to do business? So I'll just talk about two quick things. One is, this is some research we did a few years ago. And we're looking at it again because we're using this for some of the current case studies we're trying to put together. So we did a large-scale survey, and the trouble with surveys is that you get interesting things, but you sort of don't get at what's really happening. You know, you get the top level, and you can do all sorts of means and standard deviations and stuff like that, but we're really trying to get to what's going on. So I'll talk about that one, which is kind of the practical information. This one is a little bit more theory-based, so, you know, academics, you got to help me with this, and people in industry, I just want to say this to you, there's no such thing as nothing is as practical as a good theory, right? You heard that before? So. So some studies, Andy Neely at Cranfield had done some work with Oracle a number of years ago, 2007, and they've done this global survey, and there are a bunch of things, so I'm sort of minimizing it a little bit here, but basically it came out with the data quality question, which is sort of what Richard is talking about when he talks about location analytics. And, you know, spreadsheets are still king, right? So when it comes to analytics, that's what we like to do. I don't know if you've seen the Bain & Company report, just recent one that came out. BDA, Big Data and Analytics, is 11th on the list of what they call management techniques. There's not much insight in it, but you see that when you look at BDA across the different regions, North America, 27%, of the organizations are using it. EMEA is 24, and APAC is 52. So you see there's some differences that's happening across different sectors of the world in the application of big data and analytics. Now, we have to know that it's defined in different ways, as you probably don't know. So that's where we're starting our investigation and asking the question, so what are people actually doing when it comes to So this particular data set I'm looking at is, this is just some background information on it. You can see that the organizations have responded, 191 in Canada, in the East, which is China and Japan, there were 84 who responded to us. Most of them were more than 10 years old. You can see who responded on the other side of the screen. Mostly for the Canadians, executives, so those are C-level people, or the companies in the East, more the manager level, probably because, as you'll see in a minute, the Eastern companies tended to be much larger than the Canadians. So trying to get to a C-level in a 20,000-person company is not as easy as a 1,000-person company. So I think that maybe explains some of the differences. So basically, we asked them a lot of questions. I've only extracted four to talk about here today, because that leads me to the next piece, which is, when we think about the future of analytics, I mean, where are we going with all this stuff? At the end of the day, if we're not delivering value to the business, it's going to be interesting, but that's all it's ever going to be, right? So that's the good. Okay, so I've got four pictures to show you, and then something from the public sector side, which is all Canadians, because we didn't get too many public sector organizations participating from other parts of the world. The thing in yellow, so this is a scale of 1 to 7. 8 is, I have no idea. And 9 is, we're not using the technique or the tool, okay? So I put these in here because they're important in terms of understanding what's going on in the organization. So spreadsheets, as I mentioned, yeah, no big deal. So 1 is low effectiveness, and 7 is very high effectiveness. So you can just see by the picture of the frequency distribution, and these are in percentages because I had obviously more Canadian firms than I had firms from the East. And you can see that generally speaking, people get spreadsheets. So, you know, no big news there. This one is variance analysis. Now, this is important because when I get to the next piece about the future of analytics, it's an important point to understand. So what's variance analysis? Well, it's simple. If I have a target and I have an actual, I compare them and I see that I actually do what I said I was going to do. That's all it is. Okay? So you can see some interesting differences here, right? On the Canadian side, you see that, generally speaking, yeah, we're using that. It seems to be pretty effective. The Eastern companies, not so much. So 8, I have no idea what it means. 9, we don't actually use it. So, interesting result, okay. And my colleague who works at Renmin University in Beijing, so she has an interpretation of this, which I'll get to in a minute. Yeah, go ahead.
Who are the people? I don't understand. Like, you're saying, no, we don't know what variance analysis is. I don't know, so what was your sample? Like, who did you, who were the people you surveyed?
Who, the people we surveyed? So the people reporting are here, all right? So we have in Canada, board members and execs, and then over in Asia, we tend to have more manager professionals, okay? So it could be that when you get into a company where the concept of variance analysis is not really ingrained.
This is a basic analysis that everyone does.
Of course.
So I'm not familiar with variance analysis unless you mean something else.
No, so it's target versus actual. Right, and so within the survey, when we sent it out, we sort of explained what we're looking for, right? And so some of them said, I don't know, right, whether or not we're using that within the organization. And some of them said, well, we're actually not actually doing that. Now, it's not too surprising to me. I was a consultant for many years before I actually went into academia. And when I worked with managers, you know what we do? We write a plan, and the targets are in the plan. And then we completely forget about them, and we go ahead and do what we normally do. So the fact that some organizations are not doing it, not really a surprise to me. So where am I? Oh, so that's variance. Here is our BI implementation. Now, we have to be careful. So we define BI as OLAP, right? Online analytic processing. So that's the cube manipulation, because everybody has a different definition of BI. So we separated that out because that seemed to be the thing that resonated to the when we did the test of the survey. So people understood BI to be using the multidimensional analysis cube. We had a few other questions about scorecards, which I'm not presenting here. So so there's some interesting things that are happening here. So you see that in the East, 5, 6, 7, you know, the perception is that, yeah, you know, our BI implementation is pretty effective. Whereas in Canada, we're not getting that sense. And again, if you look at the Canadians, there's a large percentage of them who don't really know. Maybe they didn't really get what BI was to begin with. So it seems as if, as we saw with the Bain & Company data, Eastern companies are actually adopting and using BI a little bit more effectively than the Canadians might be. So that's what that is. And the data mining thing. So first of all, the term data mining itself conjures up different images in different people's heads, but most of them got the fact that I have a large set of data, I'm going to sort of go through it and see what comes out. So that's sort of what we get out of it. But you're seeing a lot of, I don't know if we're using it, and you know, some of we're probably not. Okay. Obviously, what happens here is we've kind of put this in a bit of an order of what we thought would be more mature techniques going on in the organization. So spreadsheets have been around forever, so you see the kind of results in spreadsheets. Variance analysis should have been around forever, but yeah. And then when it comes to BI and data mining, you see sort of different levels of effectiveness because the techniques may not be well known. As we do our jobs and we publish about how to do these things better, we assume that within the organizations, managers get a better sense of how to use these tools and techniques. So we use this as a backdrop to ask the question, if we were actually going to organizations and ask them what's going on, you know, what would we find out? So we'll come to that in a sec. Let me just show you the public sector one. This are 80 Canadian organizations in the public sector. Spreadsheets, you see, 62% claim they're very effective. Here we define effective as 5 and up on the 7-point scale. Obviously, we chopped off the 8s and the 9s at this point. Variance analysis, 47% effective. BI, 18%. Data mining, 30% in the public sector. Thought that they were doing not bad with data mining. Now here's what's happening. We currently have something called the Government Analytics Network at our university. It's 7 to 8 public sector organizations. Some of them have invested very heavily in analytics units. And so they get SAS and they get SPSS and RapidMiner and all these other tools. And so when they respond in terms of saying, I think we're doing okay, remember who's responding, right? It's the senior level people who are responding. They know they've made the investment in data mining and they're getting results. One organization that we started a case study with, the fellow who's responsible for the analytics unit says, okay, so what happens is the head of the organization, which in Canada is the deputy minister, says, I heard about all this big data stuff, let's do some of that. So they put some money aside, they hire a bunch of people, and they do that. And these people, what they do is they get the reports and they send them directly up to the senior execs. So they're saying, yeah, we're doing a pretty good job with this stuff. The trouble is the people who actually make the organization work, people in the middle, okay, they're completely out of the loop. So it's quite interesting what's going on.
So,
Frank,
when you say 12% or 7.5%, how are we going to read this? It means 80% are using it and finding, and out of that 80%, 30% is finding effective. I'm just looking
correct,
at the last
correct.
One.
So yeah, so what it says here is that
so 21% is not using, 80%
right,
is using, and
right.
out of that 80-30% is
precisely.
Making it effective.
Precisely. Yeah, precisely. So that's what we're interpreting. Yeah. It's the same model as the other one where 8 to 9 means. 9 means I'm not using it. So it does simplify it for this. So we're working with a number of them to ask the question, what do we mean when we talk about big data and analytics? Because it's a little different for every organization. And if we're going to truly institutionalize it, we need to understand it. So here's what came out of my colleague at Renmin University. I'm not sure if I spelled this right, but you know the Chinese concept of Guanxi, which says we are more about the relationships in the organization than we are about the hard and fast things that we write down on paper. So we might plan and say, here's a target. Invariance analysis doesn't come into play so much because what we're doing is we're trying to figure out amongst us where we go next. So she's doing some work on that over in Beijing to look at, does that cultural piece play a role in how we actually use analytics? So national culture as well as organizational culture. So there's some things that she's looking at there. In terms of the technology, the whole data mining or getting to BI faster, there's a sense that you know some of the countries are skipping phases, right? If you think about from landline to wireless, we go through that progression, but in some countries they go straight to wireless. So there's a perception that maybe that's happening in a lot of the companies there. We're kind of skipping the whole client-server era and going right to cloud. So if I go to cloud, I can get to BI a lot faster because I'm not dealing with the messy implementation stuff. So she's exploring some of that stuff, and our colleague in South Korea is taking a look at that. And then some natural questions would come into play. Does firm size matter? And does firm age matter? Not age of the individual, so we should put firm age. And so here we got rid of 8 and 9s and then used the scale to take a look at those four things, right? So spreadsheet, BI, data mining, and variance. And for firm size, interesting result. The middle firms seem to do a little bit better with variance analysis than the very big or the very small. So either in the very big, the whole variance analysis thing is getting completely lost because you can't keep track of stuff. Very small, they're not ready to do it yet, but the middle firms seem to be okay with that. Does age matter? So the older the firm is, the more effective they say the variance analysis and the spreadsheet use tends to be. So there's a notion within the literature, especially the IT literature, this notion adaptive structuration. This is Tisakis and Poole and Oligowski who talked about this. And the logic is that once we put into a social system any kind of technology, the technology changes how we work, and how we work changes the technology. So the logic is that the longer I have to live with this thing, either I'm going to kill it completely and ignore it, or I'm going to learn how to integrate it into the way we do business. So part of what we're doing with the case studies to come is just to get a sense of, is that going on within organizations? You know, we started with getting our data organized. There's this notion of data-driven BI, which is get the data organized. Now we move into this notion of model-driven BI, which is can we use the data to generate insights. So the question is, have we as managers, I mean, made peace with the whole BI thing? Now we're actually starting to understand how to integrate it into the management process. Not sure, but that's the question. Any other comments before I switch gears?
Just in relation to that Guanxi concept, there's a phenomenal book written by a guy called Jeffrey Walsham back in around about 2001 or two, called which is all about cultural aspects of IT.
Yeah.
And there's a couple of beautiful studies there
yeah.
about China
yeah, okay.
that shed an awful lot of light upon that aspect.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll take our comments. I'm listening to Shannon as well, so she can take a peek through that. So, you know, my research started really with this concept of growing organization. Some of you remember Peter Senge's book in 1990, which was all good fun, except nobody really knew what to do with it, right? And then, you know, when I started doing this research, it seemed to me that this notion of knowledge in organizations or knowledge-based theory of the firm, we talked about it for many years, but we didn't know how to do it. And it seems to me that big data maybe gives us an opportunity to actually do it. I'm not sure if we're approaching it from the right angle. So this is what the next couple of slides are about. Organizational knowledge creation. So my hypothesis is big data and analytics is really about organizational knowledge creation. And these folks, Cohen and Leventhal, 1990, wrote a paper in the Administrative Science Quarterly that's been quoted all over the place. And this is a knowledge creation process that says, well, we have to recognize stuff is important first, before we assimilate it, and then once we assimilate, we get to apply, right? But there's some challenges to think about. So, we're surrounded by stuff. The firm is a distributed knowledge system. It's all around us, and the question is, how do we decide which bits to focus on, which bits to ignore? Because we can't focus on everything. So, first point. Second point is, we very rarely make important decisions in organizations by ourselves, right? We have to convince somebody. I was explaining to Richard, I'm director of the MBA program as well, I explained to Richard the series of committees I have to go through before I can make a change in the program. So I need collective cognition to happen throughout the organization before we actually take action, before we actually apply. Okay? And what happens is we all get excited about all the stuff, social media this, and linked analysis and all these cool things. And then these researchers basically ask the question, what is organizational knowledge anyway? So it's an important point. They say, look, it's situation, actors, and action. I have a situation, I have actors, and there's an action I can take. So when I link those three things together, now I have organizational knowledge because it's actionable. I can actually do something about it. Okay, so these folks, the actors, have to be the ones that are convinced that that's the right action. So what comes next is from one of the case studies we just started doing, and it's an interesting model because it takes us back to variance analysis, right? So here's the logic of something like this. This comes from Inslee, the notion of situational awareness, and some of you know he did his work with fighter pilots, right? So before you push the big red button, you have to be really sure you should be shooting at the thing you're going to shoot at. So this notion of situational awareness. So what happens is before we do our plan, before we set our target, we do this external internal analysis, and then we say, okay, we understand the environment, and we know how things link together, and so we can predict performance based on that analysis. So then we create these goals. Once the goals are there, we decide and act and do things, and now we get the variance analysis. If you're not doing this, I don't know how you apply big data. It's good fun. But it's probably not driving the organization forward if you're not actually looking at your target versus your action. So what this organization did was exactly that. Now, the important points are, what they've done is, they've set a number of very specific goals that are actually measurable so that they can do that. So they set measurable goals, they do a bunch of stuff, they do variance analysis. Now, this little validate, step five, which is validate, says, before we actually cycle back and change the things we're doing, I need to do some validation. And the way they validate is by testing and experimentation before they actually launch, right? So they're gathering both external and internal data, feeding it into this thing, and then they're going back into this phase here. So the cycle around here, every so often they'll cycle up here and say, well, you know, we've had this goal the same for 4 years, we've never hit it, maybe it's something we should do about it. Or we're exceeding this by 30%, maybe we should think about what we're doing. So they cycle through this process. The other thing they had to do was, if you remember this notion of collective cognition, even though the senior managers, they can go through this process and say, we have to do this, they have an entire ecosystem that they have to convince if they're going to move forward. So, you know, there's this notion of distributed cognition. So that perceive, comprehend, predict has to percolate throughout the entire system before they get large scale movement. They've done a really good job with it because they gave it enough time to percolate to the system. They spent a year and well over $1 million getting the IT infrastructure right. They spent another 18 months training people at different levels in the system to understand and appreciate the data. They could only do that because the head of that organization insisted that they were going to be analytics driven and they wouldn't make any critical decision without support from the data. Right? So leadership at the top, we had to use it. So this is what we're learning. Some of you may have seen this, Davenport Harris's and Morrison's maturity model for data and analytics. And it all looks good, it makes a lot of sense and all that stuff. It's just that what we're seeing, it doesn't work that way. Right? The way it works is somebody gets a brilliant idea and they say, let's do some analytics, and we go ahead and start doing it. And then about a year later they say, I'm not sure that's working, so can we do something else? So it's a lot more iterative than it shows up in that particular model. And this is one of the things we're working on. If it is about driving business value, it's based on variance analysis. You can't do that without having clear goals. So you really don't get the huge value that we could get out of BDA unless we're doing the things right on the business side. So you need that kind of link between the business and the analytic models in order for it to happen. Okay, so generally speaking, data quality issues, but we kind of know how to do this, right? We've been doing this forever. We know how to capture data and all that stuff. The question is this one. How do we build these analytic-driven organizations? So management education, we're all over that. We're trying to do that. Right? Kodak moments, what that means is some of you know that Kodak going to a $19 billion business by doing a very simple thing. Taking photography, back in the 1800s, you put a hood on your head and you had a big camera this big and you had a big flash, and shrinking it to this size, that cost me a couple bucks and I can take a picture like that. So, are we getting to this point of push-button analytics where managers can kind of take their data, push a button and get the answer? RapidMiner says you can do it, right? You open RapidMiner, it says drop your data here, and it says market to these customers because they'll buy more from you. That's all it does. I mean, it does some stuff at the back, but as far as the manager is concerned, there's a system called Eureka. Same idea. Analytics in a can. All of the messy stuff at the back end is taken away from the manager, and all they do is push a button. So we need a Kodak moment. Designing for analytics, this concept of the hypertext organizations. This is Nonaka and Takeyoshi. And their logic was all organizations have this knowledge base. It's in people's heads and systems and so on. And all we really do is we wrap a business system on top of it. The business system can change, but the knowledge base pretty much evolves, right? So you can adjust it. So this is what we're trying to do by working with the case studies, is get a sense of, you know, what's working well, what are some of the challenges, and trying to do this in an international context where we compare Australia to Germany to South Korea to China and get a sense of there's some very common things that organizations have to do in order to move ahead with the application of big data analytics. So that's it. Any comments or further thoughts? Thank you very much.
Yeah, I'm just curious about how organizational memory affects all of this, right? Because you seem to be spending a lot of time instilling and training and doing all this stuff,
yeah.
So that analytics happens in a certain way.
Yeah.
And then you have the leadership component, which says it's going to happen this way. And then, so presumably, the social culture changes so that people behave in a different way that is desirable for the organization.
Yeah.
And then they retire and they quit. Or they get fired. What happens?
Yeah. That's a great point. So, you know, years ago, we used to talk about corporate memory systems. You probably remember these conversations. I was a Cognos before I went to academia, and one of the things we were trying to do is to build what we used to call decision trails. So decision trail said, we decided to acquire this company, but if a new manager comes in, I can look back into the system to see what data was looked at, calculations that were made in order to come to that conclusion. So some of that is there. I can look at the calculations, but I can't go backwards to see the data.
Yeah, it's funny, like every decade or so, one of these memory systems comes up. And it happened in academia too. I remember reading a paper about how you should rationalize the mechanism of discovery. No matter how you discovered it, you should rationalize it so that someone could follow the trail back and you'd have reasons for why you discovered it. Like it might just be Edison discovered light bulb because he tried 2,000 filaments.
Yeah.
And but that's not really a good story. So people want that story, and that helps the institutional
thing. Yeah.
So is any more of that work continuing, or is it, like, it just seems like we've thrown it all out the door, right? And now we're doing analytics, right? But that would inform a lot of.
Yeah, you know, it's like fashion, right? The lapels will get thick again, and the ties will get skinny again. It's not what happens. No, not necessarily. So I think part of the BDA thing has to be, we can do the point analytics. The question is, if we're going to make it organizational, we need some kind of a trail somewhere,
right?
One of the companies we worked with at Cognos was ViewSonic, and they were concerned about this kind of stuff. So we built a validation script that went from the Cognos content store back to the source system. So they could always see the trails of data that was moved, but that's the best we can do at this point. Once the data hits a human mind, okay, well, thanks everybody for coming, and thanks for all of the great conversations. And Aisha, thanks for having this whole cluster on this area here.
Well, thank you so much to all of you. Without your participation and dedication, we couldn't have